Hi, yeah, I'm Brad. Thanks. Well, thank you very much for inviting me down. I mean, Mickey got hold of me only a few days ago, wasn't it? Sent me a message, and I didn't know when I could make it, but suddenly I was like, oh, I could do this Monday if you can. And he's like, yep, come along. So here I am. But I suppose, what do you want? Just me to give you a brief overview of where I got to where I am now and what the journey was like and what I've done. I started off, I've wanted to be a film director since I was 8 years old. And I can pinpoint the exact moment, in fact, even though I didn't know that it was being a director, it was literally the moment my my dad pointed out to me that at that age, my favorite movies generally, he pointed out that the same guy made them. And at that age, the best movies ever made were Jaws, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, Raiders of the Lost Ark, and E.T. And I was like, and when he went, you know, it's the same guy, suddenly something went off in my head, like, wow, whatever he does, it speaks to me, and vice versa. And then you grow and you see more stuff, and you start to see there's other directors and they did other stuff, and suddenly you're like, oh my God. And then suddenly the idea of being a filmmaker sort of got into my head, and for better or for worse, never left. So literally, as soon as I left school, I wanted to get into film. I didn't do A levels, anything like that. Which meant I couldn't get into film school at that time. But what I did do was I got into a stage managing course in Guildford because I liked theatre as well. So I was. So I kind of did that and worked for a year after that in sort of fringe theatres and crewing on some West End shows and just sort of bumming around in theatre whilst I was trying to get onto a training scheme that sadly doesn't exist anymore that was called FT2, Film and Television Freelance Training, FTFT, and it was very trendy, FT2. What that did was for 2 years, it put you on onto productions as a trainee. And so you could just get to know people, and it paid you a minimum wage for those 2 years, but you got placed on all these things, and it didn't cost the productions, so they were happy to have you. And so I specialised in camera first because I was always thinking in camera shots, I worked on a TV show called Pie in the Sky. If anyone remembers that, headlining Richard Griffiths, and it was the first series of that, and it was just a cop show, the quirky cop show with him. He's a chef and a cop, and you know, it's what you do with cop shows, isn't it? You take cop and mix it with something else, and yeah. But what was amazing about that, because back in those days you shot on 16mm, so you were working with film crews, and all the crew I was working on this little BBC TV show, they were on the flying unit for Superman. They all worked on Star Wars. They'd all worked with these directors that I knew, Richard Donner, Steven Spielberg, Robert Zemeckis. They'd worked with them all, Roger Rabbit. They'd been on it all. And I was just like, this is blowing my mind. And I went, what's he like? Oh, in this bit. And they were like, oh, I don't remember that. And I'm like, oh, but that was brilliant. So I really sort of, my inner geek just sort of came out. But what I realized, even though I love being on set, and I do still say, if you want to be a director, you have to work on sets. You need to know how a set professionally works. But what you do realise is if you want to be a director, you only really find out what the director's doing in the editing suite when you see the shots coming together. So that's why my second year on that, I specialised in editing and I became a trainee editor and I worked in that field. Again, this was still on, non-linear editing was just coming in. Avids and Lightworks, they were the two beasts at the time. They were just coming in. But even movies that were shot on those, I worked on the... As an assistant editor, I worked on a movie called Fierce Creatures, which is like the sort of Fish Called Wanda sequel. Yeah. And that just went on for ages at Pinewood. It was great. But they were cutting on Lightworks, but you had to, because back in those days, you know, you couldn't project a good enough picture offline suite that would be any good. You know, the whole idea of QuickTime, things like that didn't exist then. So you literally had to conform 35mm print to that edit. So you would get an edit list, and there would be an army of us assistants you get the film cans, open it up and look at the numbers, cut there, splice it, and basically re-conform things so they could project it in a cinema and watch the cut. That's how it used to work back then. Back in those days, we were all sitting there going, this is never going to take off, you know, computer editing, nah. But then very, very quickly, the processing speed happened and it all became fantastic. But, so anyway, I carried on working and I became an assistant editor, and I worked as an assistant editor for a few years on various projects for Film 4 and Universal. My best job as an assistant editor was on a movie of Anna Karenina, directed by Bernard Rose, starring Sean Bean. And but what was great about that was they were shooting it. It was an American production, so production were in LA, the editor was in LA, they were shooting in St. Petersburg, but they didn't want to use Russian labs, so they were using British labs for the film. So they needed an assistant editor here to supervise all that. And so I was literally the only person in the country working on that film. And I could work, it was like the best paid job I'd ever had. And I could just do everything I needed to do in 3 days and have the rest of the week off. And then, at the weekends, the rushes needed to be couriered back to St. Petersburg. So every other weekend, that was my job. So I'd go out and have a long weekend in St. Petersburg, meet up with the British contingent of the crew, get very drunk on vodka and the canals, and then come home again. That was fantastic. So that was my that little period. And then after a while, I'm like, okay, I need to start thinking about what I'm going to do, because I want to be a director and all that. So I got into started making some short films, you know, sort of experimenting and playing around with some stuff. We had I got hold of some 16mm stock and shot a couple of short films on that, and then got into the what's now called the London Film School, I think, but it was at the time it was called the London International, the one in Covent Garden. And there I met a couple of people who didn't want to stay at film school, and I frankly didn't. By this time I'd been working in the industry for 6 years, and it was great to go to film school and get to make some stuff. But I was like, this is good, but I was a bit frustrated by it because by that point I'd become too practical. And I got an offer to go to New York and set up a company in New York and with me as the editor. And that, so I did. So after two terms there, I left and went to New York, and that was interesting. Had a great time there. Worked on some interesting projects, but unfortunately, it never quite grasped, never took off. So I ended up coming back. But when I came back, I was like, okay, well, I need to direct. I need to make that happen. So as a bread and butter job, I got a job for a local charity called Rainer. It was called Rainer at the time, and they wanted a filmmaker to teach filmmaking in after school clubs and summer school clubs and things like that. So I ended up doing that and ended up creating a studio in an industrial estate in Shotgate, and that was where we were basically starting off something with one of the guys from New York, but that looked like it wasn't going to go anywhere, and we had to say this isn't going to work, but before we leave this place we want to do something with it. So we knew that we didn't have long, so it was literally a case, so I said, well, you know, fuck it, we've got to make a movie. You know, let's do it. So that's what we did, and that was well, I didn't know what the hell we were going to do. We were auditioning actors, and I was writing the script as we went. Like, I was like, what characters am I auditioning tomorrow? Right, I better write some scenes for them. But basically, we had this whole spirit of just people coming together and having a laugh and making. And the project was designed to be a sort of Peter Jackson / Roger Corman style sort of piss-takey fun movie. Which ended up being a solemn night. That's where I met Lydia. Lydia answered a call out that was put out for people that wanted to come and help us make this thing. And that was so we made this thing, and it's quite funny, I think, and it's quite but it definitely shows its budget, and it's definitely very tongue in cheek, and that. it was called Asylum Night because it's set in the same asylum on Christmas. Asylum Night. There's a pun there. You might get it. It was about, talk about Erin Allen. I based it on, basically in the basement of this asylum, they were holding vampires and they were feeding the inmates to the vampires. And it was, you know, because they were trying to find out the secret to eternal life, some bullshit like that. And of course, on Christmas Eve, the vampires get out and they start biting the insane patients, they start turning into vampires, it all goes crazy. But whilst all this happened, there's a Christmas party happening on the top floor, which was totally supposed to be like Towering Inferno. They're all up there, and the disaster's coming up, and none of them know, and they're all like, rah! And then it all kicks off. And it's not very successful. It's fun. But what we did do is we got it out to some festivals, we got it released in America, we won an award in Edinburgh with it. The Troma Fling Award, Troma gave us an award for it, for best feature film. So it was right up there, Ali. But it was a good experience, and it really sort of kickstarted everything to that spirit of, look, with the right people, the right attitudes, the right skill sets, you can make things happen. So then a career for me after that was mainly whilst trying to get another movie off the ground, was directing music videos mainly, and that was what I basically ended up doing, a lot of that and editing and doing some bits and bobs like that. And my next feature film that I was trying to get off the ground was a film that at the time was called Flat 7, but it ended up being retitled Beacon 77 after this website that's in it. And that took 5 years to get funded. And it was a long old process. Learned a lot on the way of that, which included, we ended up in, I'm going to tell you warts and alls, because I think, you know, there's no point in sugarcoating anything, because the reality, because back at the time you had the Arts Council, and you had the Eastern version of the Arts Council, it was called Screen East. Now we won favour with them, and Asylum Night got us favour with them because we were in contact with them. They took a group of filmmakers from the Eastern region out to the American film market in LA. This all has a point, by the way. I'm sorry. And we went out there, and of course we had our little Asylum Night movie. And we'd aimed it for this company called York Entertainment, who specialised in distributing this kind of thing. And we'd sent it to them, and they turned it down. Anyway, we ended up having a meeting with the same company again while we were out there. And this is with Screen East, this is with all them, and there we are. There's all these people with all these sort of, you know, better projects, and there's us with our stupid little vampire film. And we had this meeting with York Entertainment. And the woman that we met with was the woman that we'd been corresponding with. And we said, "Oh, hi, we sent you our movie, Asylum Night." And she was like, "Oh, the one with the blood splats on it." It had blood splats on the cover. She went, "The one with the blood splats?" We went, "Yeah, yeah." She went, "Oh, I love that." We went, "Oh, did you?" "Yeah." She said, "But I got voted out." I said, "I wanted it." She said, "If there's anything happens with it, if it wins any awards, let me know." And we just won this award in Edinburgh. We went, well, funnily enough, so she went, "Okay, well, let me go and tell them." Anyway, and then before we left LA, we had a phone call from basically offering us distribution in America for it. So Screen East were like, so we were the only people that did a deal under this trip that Screen East did. Well, it was me and the producer, Janice. We were out there
so
together.
How many people do you normally have working
with? Well, it depends on what phase. I mean, when you're making a project, it's usually you and a producer on either side of it. In the middle, you have lots of people. I mean, the cast and crew for Beacon was about 25. Cast and crew for Hallows Eve got to about 35 on some days. And then it suddenly goes back to just you again, sort of doing it all. I dread to think we probably had a lot of people because we had a lot of turnover because like lots of people came for a bit and didn't. But there's probably no more than sort of 10 people at one time on the set, I shouldn't think. For sure. But that was shot on digital video. That was. So it wasn't. It was. And I DP'd it. I DP'd the first week, and then Shu came along and took over because I was like, I can't do it all. So in LA, it's just me and Jack, the producer, that got taken out there, and we did this deal, and screenings were like, oh, you're our success story with your little vampire film. So they then started looking at our other projects, and there was this other project that at the time was called Flat 7, and we went into development with them for 3 years, which was a very positive experience for the first section of it. And then right at the end, suddenly all these obstacles started being put in our way that were like coming out of nowhere and didn't make any sense. And we were like, what's going on? But we kept doing what we were supposed to do. Right? And then suddenly we were told, I'm sorry, we're not going to fund your film. And we were like, oh, okay. And then I think about a week later, Screen East was shut down and the financial director was arrested. So that's just a little... story about how the Arts Council used to work. So when obviously the Arts Council was disbanded, and everyone was up in arms, typical Tories. I was sitting there going, I don't know. There's a lot going on that you don't know about. No, it was Screen East. It was part of the Arts Council set up. So what else went on, I don't know, but that's just our story, and that's all I know about Screen East. But the whole public funding of films in this country is an interesting maze to traverse for all kinds of reasons, but I'll say no more because I'm being filmed. So you spend 3 years of your life doing that, you know, building up, and then suddenly, boom, it's gone. And you're like, well, what do I do now, you know? And this was about the time, now, up until this point, I was, and I confess it, a 35mm snob, as in I was a celluloid snob. Up until that point, digital did not interest me. I was absolutely not interested. Film and digital, there was no comparing them. Why not?
Yeah.
Because everything I saw looked like very good quality video. Yeah. Up until that point.
What year are we talking?
We're talking 2008. Oh. Yeah. So we're going back a bit, but what then I took note of was when Red started to develop their technology, and when I was looking at Red, I was like, Because their technology, they were starting from stills, digital still technology, not digital video technology, to create high definition video, and then it was going to be 4K and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, okay, this I'm interested in. Got a music video gig, and the first Reds had sort of started coming in the country, so I was like, I'm going to shoot this on Red, and I'm going to see what it's like. So did, saw it, loved it. I was like, yes, I'm now a convert. Not that at that time, you know, I'd still rather shoot on film, but it totally was a game changer, total game changer. And when that happened, I rang up, and we were like licking our wounds from this Screen East debacle, and I rang up my producer Jan, and we'd kind of agreed to sort of like take 3 months away from everything, just sort of step away for 3 months and get ourselves back in. You know, we'd agreed that the previous night, the next morning, I rang her up and went, I've got an idea. I said, look, there's this new tech, the Red tech. I think, because there was a little bit of private investment that had been built. You have to get some private investment, even with the big money. So a little bit of private investment, a few investors that we had convinced to give us a bit of money. And I said, if we can convince these guys just still to give us their money, and we shoot on Red, I think we could do it. And she went, oh, bloody hell. I went, no, we can. So we did. I convinced them. At that point, we had Movie House Entertainment on board. They are the sales agent. Now, if you're going to be an independent filmmaker, sales agents are part of your life. You need to find a sales agent that either likes you or likes your project, but preferably both. And for some reason, Movie House Entertainment really liked us, really liked Beacon, and they were on board. And so we rang them up and told them the plan. And they said, Brad, do you believe you're going to make that the movie you pitched to us? I said, yes. And they said, well, then we are still on board. And because they stayed on board, that little pool of investors stayed on board, and everyone was happy. Because the sales agents are the people that take the movie out to the international markets and sell it to distributors. And they're the ones that do all that. And so it's kind of your stamp of approval, basically, on an industry level. So we set about making this movie that became Beacon 77 in most countries. Here in the UK, when it ended up getting the release here, they changed the name to The Seventh Dimension, which I didn't like. We had lots of arguments about that. I think I described it as sounding like it should be on the Sci-Fi Channel at 3 p.m. starring Dean Cain, but that was my impression of it. But anyway, no offense to Dean Cain, I love Dean Cain. But we ended up selling that movie, went around the world. We sold it to 20 territories, and it got to open the Lee Toro Film Festival, and it got nominated for the Silver Melier in Brussels, and it got a cinema release here, a limited cinema release here, and then Sky release and everything like that, as The Seventh Dimension here. But that was a movie that we shot literally, for not enough money to make a movie, and the whole set is a build. 90% of it was shot on a soundstage at Three Mills. Three Mills. I keep wanting to say East London Studios. Three Mills Studios, and that was quite an undertaking. Now, and the DP that I got on board. There's a guy called Tim Worcester. He's fantastic. He's currently second unit DP on Star Wars. He's just finished being second unit DP on Wonder Woman and Kingsman 2. So he's big time in the second unit game now. I mean, back then, his dad was a guy called Arthur Worcester. I don't know if anyone knows that name, but Arthur Worcester was the second unit director for all the Bond movies from... I think his first was The Spy Who Loved Me and all the way up to Goldeneye. He was the second unit director on those movies, and Tim brought him along to our screening of Beacon. I was like terrified. He really liked it. But just to break up me yabbering on, I'll show you the trailer for Beacon if you're interested. But just to let you know that this was a film that we shot for... It wasn't touching 100 grand, put it that way. And it's all set. Pretty much everything you're going to see here is a set. Anyway, I'll show it to you.
What sort of cam are you using?
Sorry?
What sort of cam are you using?
This was shot on Red One.
Red One?
Yeah.
And we hope it's going to work technically with people. What we want is the volume of this down, don't we?
I can bring the volume down on this a bit if it's too high.
That will need to feed the little amp with a line out.
Oh, I see.
We've got a remote and we've got a...
Is that the case?
Well,
no, that's your case, isn't it?
Isn't
that your case there?
Yeah.
So how much is the Red One camera?
Yeah, I mean, this is... We're going back now to 2010.
That's an early version.
So, yeah.
The cases for the...
Well, the red, yeah. I mean, the red ones definitely have. I mean, the Epic Dragon is the latest, and that's what I shot my latest movie on.
Tens of thousands?
At the moment, you can probably pick up a red one for probably about 10, under 10.
But the lens
is always the...
And the Red Dragon. So my uni had two, and every week.
But see, we're all scored in 35mm cameras, 60mm cameras, so GoPro. Well, you're going to see shots I did on one of those in one of the later ones I'm going to show you. Yeah, there's more. Sorry, I'm going to talk for a little while. Okay, so yeah, this is my first theatrically intended feature film.
And you wrote this too, did you, Brad?
I did, yes.
You wrote it.
Yeah. Yeah.
What insignificant thing snowballed into a monumental event and caused this?
God is a popular subject here on the Beacon, do you believe? Amongst other things, we are involved in the re-education of the masses. The authorities aren't entirely happy that Beacon77.com is being used as a refuge for the insane ideas which are alien to those who should know better.
What the hell kind of people are you?
We're hacking into the Vatican's private archives, tracking down the earliest version of the Torah. This program lays out the entire text as if it was one humongous word, and we form it into a matrix of it. The word search is where there are words, significant words, cross each other, hidden in the text. What, so the Vatican's sending in ghosts to scare us off?
What the hell? Open the door! Psychics and ghosts and weirdos!
All that information becomes an ability to predict the future.
He's unhinged, Henry.
Thank you. Following on from your question, the script for that was a script that I wrote, and then it was rewritten by somebody else when we were going through the development process with Screen East, which was fine. I didn't mind that. In fact, she was really, really good. Then when we came away, I did my own new draft of it, particularly as we were going ahead on a new budget, so I had to compensate.
How many hours of film was involved in that to get it down to that trailer? How many hours of footage in that to cut it down?
I couldn't tell you what the ratio was now, I forget. But I mean, the movie itself is 91 minutes. The edit for the movie was done first, and then the trailer was cut out of that.
Several months, is it, a film in 91 minutes?
Oh, we shot for 21 days.
21 days?
Yeah. Sorry,
I just wondered if the trailer in chronological order, or have you mixed up?
It's mainly in chronological. It's a little bit mixed up. A few of the more exciting final act things are brought a little bit forward just to give it a bit of oomph. But it's generally, I mean, essentially that the idea behind it, and the reason why the original script was called Flat 7, and we had to change it because no one else apparently lives in flats except for us. was I wanted it, and everyone was like, "Well, that sounds a bit boring." I was kind of, but that's the point. The whole point was is a massively, you know, world changing event is happening in the most insignificant place possible, and that's the whole thing. And the whole theme of the film is you know, small things snowballing into larger events and things like that. So it's a bit of a mind bending film. Some people when it first got released, the critical response wasn't good, and except for the Radio Times, for some reason the Radio Times loved it. So I had the Radio Times review. I didn't like the strategy that the distributors had in this country, and I made my feelings on that quite well known, and I was told not to come to meetings anymore. because I just thought they were releasing, this wasn't the kind of movie that fit that strategy. And the best strategy was France. France had a great strategy, and they and their poster made it look like a thriller. Not here, they try to sell it as a science fiction horror, whereas really it's a supernatural thriller. And so if you go in thinking you're going to get a science fiction horror, the first two acts are going to bore the hell out of you, you know. But if it's marketed as a slow burn supernatural thriller, then and that's what they did in France. And France was by far our most successful territory. So you know,
but down well in Japan,
oh yes, it did go down well in Japan. Japan loved it, and they had a very interesting poster as well. You get sent all the posters to approve. Contractually, you're allowed to approve it, but if you say no, they're going to go, well, we're not going to release your film then.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah, you got but yeah, they had this interesting tactic of taking one of the girls' bodies and the other girl's head and putting them on top of each other. So yeah, that was the Japanese. Obviously, like one of their faces and the other one's cleavage. But that was.
And it was subtitled in these countries, was it?
Subtitled in subtitled was in all of them and dubbed in a few. The French dub was amazing. Jonathan, the actor who's in the wheelchair in that, he's not really in a wheelchair, but in the part he's in a wheelchair. So I had lots of arguments with people in the development phase about the length of the film, because the script was about 112 pages long, and they kept telling me you got to cut it, you need because this can't be a. And I said, trust me, this movie's not going to be much more than 90 minutes. And they go, but it's 112 pages. But because the general rule of thumb is a page a minute. Which generally does work out. But I had to explain to them, look, this character has pages of dialogue. Like, literally, you look at the script and there's just dialogue, that he's going to motor through, like just go through this dialogue. Going to eat up pages like that. Trust me, it's not. I didn't cut anything, and it turned out to be 91 minutes, but, I'm not going to blow my own trumpet with that one. But what was hilarious about that was watching the French dub. Me and Jonathan sat down together and watched the French dub. So there's this poor French guy, obviously trying to keep up with him. And we were so impressed, we sent a message to the French distributors to say, can you please send out congratulations to the actor that dubbed him, because he did a magnificent job. So, yeah, watching your movie in different languages is hilarious. It's brilliant. And it's also great, because you're like, wow, this is... It's almost like, you've made it, Look, there's a Japanese version. And just under 20 territories it ended up going into, and was fairly successful. Not financially. Financially is a different kettle of fish, because so many people would take part of the pie, and you, the person that spent 7 years of their life on it, is at the end of that. But it did okay. So I'm like, right, great, let's. Everyone's going to like be clambering for my next project, aren't they? 5 years later, I'm carrying on making music videos, carry on in that, and anyway, we had another project that we were in development with. It was a book adaption, which ended up falling out with the publishers on that. But the author, who was a really good friend of ours by that point, really was really upset by that, and he handed us another book that he said, look, I've got the film rights to this one. See if you like it. And if you like it, well, I'll give you the film rights. And we did, and I liked it. And so we started developing that. Me and the producer ended up parting ways, so I ended up going alone. And I was developing this thing, but things were just getting, again, nearly there, people interested, and then collapses again. And This is the game you have to play. You it's a long game. So around about 2.5 years ago, I was in such a bad mood. I decided to try and I decided to spend 2 weeks in a coffee shop writing something really dark and upsetting, something to annoy the world as much as I was annoyed. And I'd either finish this in 2 weeks or kill myself on caffeine, one or the other. So I ended up sitting and writing this. I had this germ of an idea, and I started writing it, and it became this movie called Hallows Eve, which was the first thing I had written that no one else has written, that no one else has touched. And And I've been involved in other scripts, been asked to write other scripts, developed other scripts with other people. So I'd, by this point, I feel I was a much better writer. I'd got my chops a lot more on that, and I just felt I had this. So I started writing this one called How's Eve, and I wrote it purely with the idea that by this time I become good mates with a director of photography who lives in Rayleigh. He's a very interesting guy. His name's Bob Horwell. I don't know if any of you have ever come across this guy. You obviously have, yes. He's a DP. He lives in Rayleigh. He's got his own facility company called Indie Film Hire. He's also co-owner of a studio in Loughton called East London Studios. And he's got two Epics, an Alexa, about three red MXs, and all the lenses you can, you know, if you want Kubrick lenses, he's got them. He's and lights and everything he's got. He's kind of an independent facility, really. And when I found out about him, I used to when I was making music videos, I used to just hire things off him, particularly lenses. I'd hire lenses off him. He's got such good lenses. Because of that, we became friendly, and he'd said to me something a while back that was like you know, he started seeing some of my stuff and everything. He said, Brad, you know, we should do something together. He said, you know, we should, you know, if anything comes along that I can help you in with, you know, investing with equipment or something, let's talk about it. So I banked that suggestion. I was like, I'm not going to waste that on a music video or something stupid like that. So I had that in the back of my mind when I started writing this script, and I was like, I'm going to design this script that I can shoot maybe half the movie completely off my own back, and then go and raise the money to shoot the second half. Stupid idea, really, but I went with it. I didn't go with it without Movie House on board. I spoke to Movie House. I finished the script, and I sent them the script, just saying, "Just have a read of this. You know, this is an idea. See what you think." And basically just to say, "What do you think of this idea? If I shot half of it, do you think I'm a madman?" Anyway, they read it and they came back to me and they said, "Brad, if you think you can do it, do it." He said, anything, basically what you learn very quickly in this business is it's an entrepreneurial business. There's no industry here in the UK. By definition, there's no industry. Which is why I get very annoyed and on my high horse and things like that when I'm talking to certain people in the industry. Every project is an entrepreneurial exercise. You've got to figure out a way. And they totally agreed with me, and they said, if you think you can do it. And they said, and if it helps you, you can say that we're attached for sales. Which is what I was really after, even though I didn't actually come out with that. Which was great, so I went, right. So then I went to Bob, and I said, right, Bob, this is my harebrained scheme. I reckon if we find the right location, we can shoot half of this movie. So I'd written, and he read it, and he was like, yep, let's do it. So we were trying to figure it out. I'd had a location in mind that a friend of mine's dad, it was an abandoned office building but they were going to renovate it and it was going to become flats or something. But at the time, it was a derelict building. So I had that in mind, and I wrote the whole second half of the movie to take place in that, because in low budget filmmaking, one of the rules of thumb is you get more bang for your buck if you stay in the same place. You know, moving crews around, moving everyone around, it's, that eats into your time and your money so much. So you can keep it in the same place. So I had that in mind, and I wrote it. But by the time it was all ready to go, the building was being renovated, and it was a no-goer. So I had to find somewhere else, and I was like, okay, I need to find this location, and I ended up, even though I didn't think of it for ages, and then suddenly, oh, the bloody nuclear bunker in Brentwood. So I went up to them and I fell in front of the guy there and told him my plight. Said, look, if you knocked your price down loads, just so I can get this part of the movie done. He ended up falling for my my charm, and and then the adventure of Hallow's Eve began. And so what happened was we shot, so I'd met Mikey already on it was Terry's film, was it? Community, yeah. Because I do visual effects as well and stuff, and I'm going to show all those monitors, by the way, they're all Burnings. In Beacon, there's 250 visual effect shots. All of them I did over a period of 6 months, went completely insane. But it was basically because there's monitors in pretty much every shot, multiple monitors, and they're all blue screens. They're all blue screen monitors, and everything had to be created and burned in. And of course, me being me on set, I'm like, oh, you know. Forget Brad, he's got to do all this, the camera's going to move in every axis possible, constantly. So that was, and of course the first time I reveal these monitors is in a 1 minute slow track through a door, and then a slight, and the monitors are going like this, or, you know, you've got to like, you know, it took me literally like 3.5 weeks for that one shot to get it all to steady. Because I do visual effects, I did the effects on the Community, and that's where I met Mikey. So there's a few friendly people around that I knew that, they might come along and help. And I completely designed the bad guys to be all in hoods, so that anyone on set could play one of the bad guys at any time. Whoever was there at any time, stick a hood on them and throw them in front of the camera. And that's basically where we went. And I got the vibe to make the movie when I decided to filter it all through a kind of an 80s John Carpenter vibe. It's modern day. And the pitch for the movie was a modern day estate gang find themselves in a late 70s, early 80s style slasher scenario. And that was kind of the pitch for it. But it was all shot to evoke that style of filmmaking, that period of films, and particularly John Carpenter. So some people joined me. I cast it, had great cast, came on board, and everyone kind of fell for the idea that we're going to shoot half of it, and then the second half, everyone's going to get paid because we'll have money. But everyone came on board, and we did it. Shot half the movie, bam, off we go. Went to Cannes, went to everywhere. You know, lots of leads nearly going there, nearly happening again, falling apart, blah, blah, blah. But by October, we shot that in January, didn't we? And then by October, I got the money through some private investment and SEIS scheme, a tax lawyer that helped me get it all together. And we were off and running. So then, a year ago, January, we started shooting the second half of the movie, and called everyone back. Everyone was good except for one cast member whose agent buggered everything up, so I had to recast him. But it all went fine, and we got the movie finished. Premiered it at Fright Fest in August, at the end of August, literally, that was the first time I actually watched the final DPX file with the sunk up sound and picture. That was the first time I watched it all the way through. Like, literally up until that moment, it was, you know, we were grading, we were dubbing, we were doing the whole shebang. They rendered it out and had to send it straight up to Fright Fest because we were going to run out of time. So we had the premiere at Fright Fest. I got very drunk and sat there going like this, and it seemed to go down really well. And I was then invited to screen it at the BFI, which I then did a Q&A for afterwards. And a good director friend of mine called Mark Price interviewed me, and I prepped some stuff because it was all about showing young filmmakers how they can utilize things. So I had some shots that I've got some of that footage, and I'll show you that. So that became Hallow's Eve, and I can show you the trailer for that now if you would like.
Yes, please.
Do you know which ones it is? I can show them your face on a clip in a bit if you want.
We can pause a bit.
yourselves home before the lights go out.
There's intruders in my house. They've attacked my
brother. Who are you?
Bass was blowing out a little bit.
Great patience.
Yeah.
Was it lots of
great? Well, yeah. The a lot of that. In fact, there's actually a shot I can show you. I think it's in the trailer, so I'll just bring it here. But where is it? Oh yeah, here. Right. This shot here. Sarah, the lead actress, she's in the bunker. A year and a few days before we shot this. That's a whole different location to there. And that's basically, yeah, that, and that's, and understanding how you can pull these little tricks off is kind of key in knowing how to maximize these sort of things. No, it's literally just a mask effect. So literally, she's there, she comes in, there's a feather mark just in the shot, she goes ahead of it a little bit, but it was, yeah, it wasn't a green screen, it was literally just framed so that it would be simple enough to do it. And that's, yeah, a bit of effects knowledge goes a long way. For example, I can show you something here, because I've got these prepped for the talk I gave. Where is it? Simple VFX, there we go. Because I was showing the guys. Oh yeah, this is a shot. Were you here for this, Rick? I don't think you were. This was a pickup shot. This is just the street down my road. Oh, this is my road. My house is just there. And there's a bus up there. And I needed this shot of Sarah arriving, getting off the bus and coming back to the estate. And we stood there. The bus that was scheduled never turned up. We were standing there for like 45 minutes. We were like going. And I just went, and at least you got to the point where I went, sod it, I'm going to comp a bus in, just film it. So we did. So this is the original footage of her just sort of going, and then you'll see that we'll cut through it again with the bus that is comped in. So that bus isn't really there. So I put that bus in, and then she comes walking around here, and then, oh yeah, so we couldn't have naked flames in the bunker. So there's lots of shots of Sarah wandering around with a candle, but as you can see, that's not actually a candle, it's just a little light. So we use that light to project onto her face, but here I've added in the flame. So that's a simple effect, just by shooting a flame against black. And oh yeah, right, and this is the start of where we had to maximize our one police car that we had. So this is one police car. This is comped in onto a TV screen. You'll see it's there. But now there's two police cars. So that's the same police car, just in two different places. And here, okay. Here goes our police car, right, and then nothing else, and then a random taxi goes by. Here he goes. There he goes. And I thought, right, I'm going to use him. Right, so here's it. Here goes one police car, here goes another police car, here goes another one, and then here comes a taxi, and you see I've stuck a little blue and yellow on the side of the taxi, so it looks like a police car. Little does that taxi driver know he's in the movie. So little things like that, and knowing what you can get away with. And again, you know, obviously there's effects you can do on a budget, and they're going to look terrible. Sorry. On that shot. Well, it's literally for this. Well, it's not so much layers. It's more. I mask out there.
Yes.
And when that police car goes by, I then take two police cars from two other takes, and I mask around them and comp them in as well. But the reason you mask around them is so that it goes behind the screen properly. So it's only two layers, really. But there's more than two layers, but they're going one after each other. They're not on top of each other. So it's kind of two layers.
Do you do that sort of effect with something like Sony Vegas?
I guess so. I wouldn't know. I work in After Effects. So this is all done in After Effects. But the principles are much the same. If you can cut out layers and control the masks well enough, you can, if you shoot it right, again, you can't do something like this. See, I'd planned for this. I knew I was going to do this. So I made sure it was a locked-off shot, which made it a million times easier. If it wasn't a locked-off shot, it would have been more complicated. So as long as you pre-plan this stuff, it was just by luck that taxi went by, and I thought, well, I'm going to stick some red and yellow on the side of him. So that's all how you can like increase the production value of it. So we had that, and we Hallows Eve. I can tell you, I know people have been bugging me about what's going on with Hallows Eve, but we, for the last 2.5 months, we were negotiating with Sony to release it here and in the US, and that deal fell apart just a couple of weeks ago, which is a bit annoying. And I know who to blame, Ghostbusters, but because Sony had their worst year last year, and whoever it was that didn't check that China wouldn't release movies with supernatural entities in it, that it's their fault that Sony last minute changed their whole strategy for the year and culled all the titles they were about to sign. AMC are looking at it right now, and a few other American distributors are looking at it. So at the moment, this is a movie that can't be seen anywhere. It's not been, but it's...
Have you tried the British ones?
Well, movie house have been talking to everyone, so yeah, probably they don't give me the, they only tell me who's biting, so whoever they're talking to that doesn't bite, they don't tell me. We've shown it at the beer at Fright Fest, so at the moment I'm trying to get it into some American festivals right now. It's in its early life at the moment, which is fun. I'm just trying to find it. Where is it? Oh yeah.
Sorry, the editing program you said you use, is that an Apple? Is that a Mac?
I cut in Premiere on Mac. I used to be Final Cut.
So you use Apple as your choice.
This is the opening shot of the movie, and this was shot on a GoPro.
Okay.
This has been shown on the massive screen at the BFI,
okay.
And it looks amazing.
And this is with
a little drone on a GoPro flying over an estate. I think it was just HD. I did in After Effects. You have to go in and flatten it out. You look at the original footage and it's like going over. Yeah. But these two tower blocks aren't
that's
really
interesting, because this particular one I've just bought actually does it automatically for you. So
does
you
it?
Trim all the fish eye.
Oh wow, great! Great. Well, I thought they should do that
that's
at some point. There he is, that's his shot. How much, sorry? The movie?
Yeah.
We made it for 93K. Yeah. Yeah, which is not a lot.
There is no
And that's a green screen out the window. Well, yeah, God did that. But this was all shot on, most of it was shot on the Epic Dragon. We had a couple of shots we did on an Alexa because the Dragon wasn't available. But it was all Epic Dragon. And because of the sensitivity of the Dragon chip was how we could, with very minimal light, shoot all that stuff in the bunker because it's so sensitive. It's amazing. It really, like, Alexa was taking over, but the Dragon has got red back in the game in terms of feature film cameras. So that's Hallows Eve. So we're now trying to get distribution for it, and it's a long old game, but we'll see what happens. I've got a short film that we've got in the short film corner at Cannes, and it's been considered for competition, but whether it does or not, I don't know. That's something that I shot kind of off my own back. Well, actually, it wasn't my idea; it was somebody else's, and it was two actresses that wanted to do something, and we just ended up doing it. And we screened that at the BFI a couple of weeks ago, and that went down really well. I got it's been reviewed really well as well. We got a great review out of Fright Fest. Kim Newman has his review ready for it. He's told me, but he's not going to let it out until we get distribution. So I have no idea. He said, "I've got my notes." He said, "I'm like, oh God." I generally shoot in 2:1 with the aim of cropping it to 2:3:5. If I'm shooting in 2:3:9, it would really been 2:3:5. So you shoot that and then you've got a bit of wiggle room with the framing if you need to. The good thing about shooting on the red and the 4K or the 5, I mean the epic we shot on, I mean the epic you can shoot on 6K, but we kept it at 5K. Cause I was like, come on, give the hard drives a break. But the good thing about that, especially when you're doing low budget and going crazy and you're running out of time, is that as long as you've got a good focus puller, and this is key, as long as you've got a good focus puller, I can be shooting my medium and my close-up at the same time. So my medium shot can be doing that, and I can punch into there without losing any resolution. If you're going to master at 2K, we always master at 2K. I mean, that's still the cinema standard, even though 4K is...
You say punch, you mean zoom?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I can punch it on the picture and literally crop it in. And you can, yeah, so if you've got a 5K picture. Sorry, yeah, no, I throw things out. No, please, don't worry. Just let me, if you need me to clarify. Yeah, no, exactly. It's a way, and it's not a preferred way because I prefer to be creating the image that I want to use. But when you're up against it, and
so
you're like,
you can't zoom it out, basically.
We don't actually do a zoom in. It's just that if I shoot here in 5K,
yes,
it means that a 2K image, which is cinema resolution.
Yeah.
So if that's my 5K image, my 2K image is that within that. So I can crop in, yeah. So that's a tool that I use a lot when we're shooting with red, is it because of that resolution,
right.
And it's okay, not.
So basically,
yeah,
you're taking that and then in the edit you're cutting.
Yeah, and I can have that, so I can intercut between those two
and
use it as an edit. But it's not a preferred thing. It's just a great time saving thing if you're really up against it, So that's that really. That's where I am at. We're I've got a few other films in development right now. I'm attached to another couple of movies that other people are trying to get funded, and that's great, including Movie House. This Movie House Entertainment have now got a production arm, and they're in their first production has gone into production.
What sort of funding did you need for that film you first showed us? What sort of funding?
Beacon.
200,
that was no, that was about the same, about 90.
90K.
Yeah.
Quite low budget, then.
Very, very low budget.
I was interested in your 112-page script because the Beefy's script was 19 pages.
Yeah.
The first half hour of that film was very sound.
Yeah.
What film was that?
Rafifi.
I mean, it's the the whole rule of how long a script should be is it fits a model that is a standard movie, but there are movies that play either side of that and don't, you know, conform to that. But to me, it's quite obvious when they don't. You know, it's like you don't need to be an expert to look at this and go, oh, this script's running short, but that's obviously going to go a lot longer over there, or vice versa. So the art of script writing is something that is very, very important. And like I said, I've only just, with Hallows Eve, been confident enough to follow through with something that I've written entirely myself. It's your script's got to be right. Sorry.
90K means you've got all your equipment.
Yeah.
You've already got your equipment, basically. The 90K is to actually produce the film. That isn't part of purchasing equipment, or is it?
No, with Beacon, that a lot of the equipment came out of that. Hallows Eve was hard enough, and that we shot half of that movie for nothing, and then the other half for 93K with the entire equipment for free. I don't know how the hell we did Beacon on that money. That was a whole set build. How the hell did we budget that? I don't know. I don't know how we did it. You look back on some of these things and you go, what the hell were we thinking? But, you know, sometimes it's like, you know, in hindsight, you look back at things and you're like, well, you know, if you were trying to think logically about things, you wouldn't get anything done. You know, sometimes you just got to dive in and that's it. So I'm basically a mixture of old school, versed in you know, large budget filmmaking in terms of my training, and I know how large things, and that meshed with a complete guerrilla, we've got a stick and we've got a door, let's make a movie type mentality. You know, I'm a hybrid between the two. So I try and make sure that everything I do hopefully looks cinematic, looks bigger and larger than what the budget should dictate. And most people in the industry, when they find out how much we made our movies for, they do go, wow. And that's not me, you know, saying, oh, I'll be brilliant. That's just me saying, with the right knowledge and the right people. The DPs that I've used, I couldn't have done it without them. The production designer who designed both the movies, I couldn't have done it without them. And, everyone coming, I think the main thing that you have to bring to it is the enthusiasm and sell people on the love of it, and then you'll find that they'll do anything for you, and that's the main thing. I mean, it's true. I mean, there was one on our last night day of pickups on Hallows Eve. We were all, the technical gods came at us and completely buggered everything up. Which is why we ended up shooting something on the Alexa, and we were running there, and because this was the last day, it was like there's no, you know, this was it. James, my first AD, said, Brad, we're not going to make this. And I said, I know. I said, what would you realize? I said, look, if I can get an extra half hour out of everyone, if no one minds, because, you know, people were getting paid very, very low wages, you know, even though they were getting paid for it, it's still not a lot. So you try not to take the piss. I said, if everyone's willing to give me an extra half hour, I can rethink some of these shots and we can get it done. So the ADs went around and asked everyone, and everyone was like, of course, because and this is the very end of the movie. They have no reason to do that, but I think because they know that in everything we'd done, I had considered them and I'd looked after the crew. The goodwill is there, and that's not me being cynical about it. It's just a general atmosphere you've got to create. And I don't understand directors that are getting bad movies. I don't understand them. Look what you're doing. I mean, this is the most amazing thing you can do. Yeah, things go on top. Things can go crazy. And sometimes, I mean, and I have to walk away from set on a couple of occasions. But it's mainly down to people. Mainly down to people who are annoying you. But in general, you know, this is fun, man. This is good fun. Let's enjoy it.
Because you're using, presumably, talent that is self-employed.
Yeah.
They don't work anymore, do they? They just sell their talents.
Yeah.
It's ministry. It's, I'm self-employed. I've been self-employed all my life. I can't see that it's a problem.
Really?
I think you find that with things like, with all kind of, with the regulations that come in that dictate certain things, in this game, they never even come up. mainly because the only regulations are only going to be used against you if the person wants to complain. If the person wants to say this is not what I'm doing, you know, and that never happens. Most people in this business, they, as long as they know what they're getting into, as long as they is very clear up front what the situation is, what the money is, what we're doing, and as long as you don't ever step beyond that without consultation, there's never, no one, you know, it never comes up. People, what the money is, what we're doing, and as long as you don't ever step beyond that without consultation, there's never, no one, you know, it never comes up. People just, as long as they get the money they were promised, they go and they're happy. Mm. Because it's a game of contacts, and everyone, to a lot of people, they do these things more for the contacts than the money. As long as you're paying them enough that they're not, you know, losing money, as long as they can pay their rent, but they're doing it because they want to get involved with productions that could come to other things. Yeah, exactly. And that is a thing that people do it for.
Got four credits out this
one, didn't you? Wow, we were generous. How did you get four? There you go. See, yeah, they are.
Does your name come up?
I think it does. Yeah.
Slow it down. Yeah. On Channel 4, they always make you go ever so small.
Oh yeah, well, I tell what's coming up next. Yeah. So anyway, that's me. So yeah, I mean, by all means, if you ask me any questions or whatever, I don't know what, if this is any use to you. I mean, I don't know what it is you guys are up to and what you're planning on doing, but...
Well, it's great to see where you've come, where you're at, and how much hard work goes into it.
Yes.
Mm, thank you. Yeah, it's you've got to be... to work in this game professionally, you've got to be, as I said, an entrepreneur, you've got to be tenacious, you've got to have a massive sense of humour, and you've got to love it. Got to love it, yeah.
There's no writer and a technician, aren't you?
Yeah.
You know this shot can be accomplished.
Exactly.
And yet you're in the writing sphere and you've got to go into the technical sphere.
Exactly, yeah. Well, yeah, but to me, those hats are so blurred to me. And I think that, directors need to be, there's the skill of directing and working on performance and communicating the idea to people, but you have to be kind of a jack of all trades. You have to have an understanding of every element, because you need to know that what you're asking for is possible,
yeah.
And that you're not asking for something that can't be done.
The trades master of none, but that isn't quite true, because basically as you get older, you become a master of more and more things. So in the end, the jack of all trades does become master of all.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I look forward to that day.
That's all it is. Time.
Oh my God! Yes. Yeah. Yeah. When you really don't want to be sometimes, but you do. Yeah.
I know. But you've got to think about team breaks. When, of course, that's not what you want to do.
Yeah.
But we all hear about crew break. Sending Shelley Duvall into frustration and tears in The Shining to get that. You know, after 30 takes, she's at her wit's end, and it's a wonderful performance. But are you allowed to do that? 30 takes? When they all go home?
If the actress isn't giving me the goods, then you know. I mean, I mean, obviously, you hear things like, I mean, that poor woman had mental problems anyway, and it's kind of gone. She's completely nuts now. Which is really upsetting and a shame. But she's you look at stuff like that, and I mean, the other example is. William Friedkin on The Exorcist, and the things that he did. He had shotguns hidden on set because he wanted to get the right shot from someone that he literally would roll it, and then he'd just pick up a shotgun and fire it next to their head. So they went like that. Now, is that right or wrong? I don't know. The crew, the cast used to come in and go to the crew like, where are the shotguns today? And they would just point them out. Back in those days, yeah. The famous thing in that as well is the guy, William Friedkin is the director, and the the religious advisor on the film, who was there constantly, he had a small part in the film, and in that part he ended up having to be the guy at the very end issuing the last rites to Father Merrin when he's taken on the demon and jumps out and he's dying, and he has to give him the last rites. So they're shooting. So this poor guy's not an actor, he's the religious advisor. He's an actual priest. And he's doing the last rites, and Friedkin's going, Friedkin's like, oh God, like this is, he's dying, for God's sake, you know. He's taking on a demon. Demons are real. He's dying. He's like, and he's doing this. And he's like, oh God. And he said, and he turned around. And he went to the cameraman. Keep rolling. And he went up to the guy. He said, listen. Do you trust me? Do you really trust me? And he went, yeah, of course. And he went, bam, action, whack the guy in the face. It's a priest. Whacked him in the face. Action. So that in the shot, he's doing this because he's just been lumped in the face by the director. Now, I love Friedkin. I love The Exorcist. I love all that stuff. Is that necessary? I don't know. Can you not just got a good actor to do it? I don't know. It's debatable. But in the heat of creation, in the heat of the moment, when you're trying to get that shot to work, yeah. It's yeah. Crazy things can happen. They can.
They did it to Alan Rickman in Die Hard. When yeah. He gets dropped at the watch. Oh, yeah. They told him to go over the count to three and then drop you. And went, okay, you ready? And then just dropped.
Yeah.
You.
So that look on his face is genuinely Alan Rickman going, fuck, because he wasn't ready. And they literally, yeah, McTiernan was a bit of a bugger for that sort of stuff as well. But there's, you know, and you can have, there's certain things that you can do with that. I mean, it's a great moment in John McTiernan's remake of Thomas Crown Affair where he gave two different instructions to Rene Russo and Pierce Brosnan. Which basically meant, you know, basically was one was, you know, Rene Russo, okay, he's going to let go and you run off that way, and then he went to Pierce Brosnan and said, don't let her go, and so you just literally got two actors that, so you then had this complete real struggle that happens just for a moment, and it's a real moment, and they do it, and then he goes cut, and then he laughs, and everything, you know, that's a tame version, that's a nice, and sometimes you can do things like that, and you can play with stuff. And you can give the actors surprises, and sometimes they like it, sometimes they don't. I've never resorted to anything quite that dramatic yet.
And the actors get all the glory.
Well, you know, so they should. It's their faces up there. Yes,
I've had a book question. Okay. Yeah. Sure.
if everyone's got their skill set that they want to bring and do it, if there's what you know that little list there is like, I mean, it's like a, you know, like what you do when you make a movie, it's like, you know, make sure you got people to do that, people to do that, people to do that, and I think the only advice is make sure everyone's aiming for the same thing. And as long as everyone's happy, and of course, and sometimes if people are doing the job that they'd rather be doing another job, as long as everyone's aware that they get to do that next time or whatever, I think as long as people don't get disillusioned. But again, I think that's almost, you know, schoolish. I think if everyone's just batting in the right direction, if everyone's gets what it is you're trying to do, and everyone's enthusiastic. Then that's fine. As soon as I finished shooting Beacon, the day after we wrapped Beacon, I then went to a friend of mine's short film and focus pulled for him. So I literally just wrapped a movie that I directed, and now I was a focus puller on a short film. But that was because I liked them, I liked the project, I liked what they're doing, and I wanted to help. And it was also lovely to be on a set and not be the director. That's amazing. Sometimes it's like on Community, things like that. When I go on other people's movies and I'm not, no one's looking at me. No one gives a shit what I think. It's great. You know, I can just relax. See, the thing about when you're the director is nothing happens without you saying so. And it literally is, you know, questions after questions. All you're doing is answering questions. And I'm a bugger. I really play trick on my runners and my third ADs. The first AD always needs to know where the director is. You know, it's like a, you know, like if he's off set, he needs to know where he is, and he needs to know that he can be called immediately and come to set. It's just, you know, just because so many decisions are being made, and sometimes if people don't know what I want on the set, they need to call me in to figure it out. And so you always hear, or I always hear this thing everywhere I go, this little echo on the radio's Eyes on Brad. Like, you know, so basically it's one of the third ADs or the runners letting the first know that he knows where I am, and I'm, you know, and it's all fine. And it's just a thing they do. You know, I just got so annoyed by this. And so I'd wander up to the catering table and sort of go to pop myself a tea, and then Eyes on Brad, and then I'd just drop the cut and run. I'd run across the studio lot, and I'm the director of a movie, and I run into the toilets and I hide in the toilets so that these poor runners can't find me. I'm such a bugger. I really love it. I love abusing my runners. But that shit used to happen to me when I was a trainee and then an assistant cameraman and an assistant editor. You know, I used to have all kinds of gags. You know, I'm got to make tea and the sparks are locking me in the toilet. I can't get out literally for 3 hours. I can't get out because the set's all down there. You know, and the camera crew who are waiting for their tea are getting really annoyed. You know, that sort of stuff would happen all the time. And so I keep a little bit of that spirit as well. I think they enjoyed it, really. But yeah, no, it's good. But you are, you know, one day I'm self-shooting a music video with a crew of one, and then the next day I'm shooting a movie with a crew of 30, you know, and everything in between. So that I kind of operate in both those areas, and I bring a bit of them to each as well.
But,
yeah, of course.
So just in terms of like budgeting and things like that, like when does the money come for you? Because I'm just thinking it's such a long time.
5 years,
like,
7 years.
Yeah,
it's, yeah.
It's such a long time. And
yep. You know when I said you have to have a massive sense of humour?
Yeah.
That's why. I mean, and I'm not joking. Everything you described there is exactly how it is. And every process you described there is a year, 2 years, 3 years.
Yeah.
I mean, luckily the way you get the investment for a private movie through the SEIS scheme, the way that works is the investors aren't really interested in anything for 3 years, because you have that natural run of a company, a shareholders company, and then after 3 years, the shares can get, it can all get evaporated, and everyone gets their shares. So they're like, as long as they get their tax break, as long as all the paperwork's filled in for their tax breaks of that year, they're happy, and then they're not going to be worried until 3 years down the line when it's going to be time to dissolve the company and see what's what. So that buys you a little bit of time. I've had to find all this stuff out myself. You know, I'm not a business person, I'm not a financial person, I'm certainly not an accountant, but I've had to be.
Yeah.
And you have to apply for the tax credit as well, which gives you 13. The big advert is the UK tax credit for films is 25%. This is the stuff you start learning. You're like 25% of 80% of your UK spend. Okay, so which is still a lot. So that kind of roughs it down to 20%, just under 20%. So okay, that's a good chunk of money we can get. You then that works out, and then when you apply for it, what you then find out when it's the first time you've done it, your accountant informs you that. Yeah, but they won't accept that there's no, you know, you can't claim on development costs. And I'm like, well, there were no development costs. We, you know, nothing was spent until we were shooting. And I go, yeah, but they won't accept that. There's got to be a minimum of 10% development costs. So basically that 25% literally works up to 13. You know, it's literally that. So you hear all, so you figure out that you've got to allow for this. Now that 13%, now what I had to do And this is the first time I solely produced Hallows Eve, and so I did all this myself. I've got the post production now. My plan was to fund the post production with the tax credit, but what that meant was to get it done in time for Fright Fest, I had to get a loan on that. But luckily I had a good relationship with a company called Creativity Media, who are based in Tower Bridge, and they're a big feature film post production company, grading and cinema sound mixing and all that. And they're part, and they've got a company called Creativity Capital that funds things and loans things against tax credit, so that's all their thing. Now, these guys were the guys that set these companies up was my grader and my sound mixer on Beacon years ago, when they worked at a company at Ealing Studios called Met Films. So that relationship, I went to Cannes, I saw they were there, and I was like, oh, let's meet up for a drink, and we did, and they said, what are you up to, Brett? What's going on? What's the big Brett? And I told them, and they went, oh, well, what do you need? Blah, blah, blah. And I said, but I need to get it done for Fright Fest, but the money won't come through in time, blah, 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 blah. And they went, oh, let's figure something out, and bam. So that was a relationship that I'd made 7 years previous that paid off at that moment. I say paid off, obviously, until that tax credit came in, there was a £17,000 loan with my name on it, and I'm like, oh God. But that eventually it all came through. Thank Christ. But all these things happen. But without them, you don't get the movie to look that way. You don't get it to cinema spec. You certainly don't get the beautiful 5.1 surround sound mix. You don't get the M&Es. You need all the deliverables you need for it to sell a film internationally. And to TV, because there's different versions of the movies that have to be made, different sound mixes. You have your M&E, which is your music and effects with no dialogue, so that foreign territories can dub. All this stuff. It's a lot of stuff. Just to have a movie that you're going to sell to the international market, you've got to have all these deliverables, and you need companies like that to see you through with that. Well, I have done, and I'm working on a documentary at the moment. They're not things that I would generate, but people come to me with things, and I've got involved. I don't think that way in my imagination. But if someone says, "Can you shoot this, or can you help us structure this and direct it for us?" That's fine. And I'm just starting off on a documentary at the moment. About selfies, but we've got Vern, what's his face, Mini Me, he's going to be in it, and a few other people that are crazy selfies, and people that apparently are famous that I've never heard of. So I work on documentaries, but I've never generated a documentary myself. But they're fun to do. Sorry, you had to listen to me drone on.
So going back to when you first started, how close are you to still Steven Spielberg now?
Well, funnily enough, the closest I've been to Steven Spielberg was at BAFTA Awards, when I was as close to him as I am to you. And he was standing there with two BAFTAs that he just got, and waiting to have his photographs taken. And by this time, I'd worked in the business for a while, and I'd met famous people, or bumped into famous people in... And I was not, I had no problem going up to people and saying hi and all that stuff. But this one time, he was standing there, literally, this is Steven Spielberg, for about a 10-second period, there was no one talking to him. And he was just standing there waiting for, he was chatting to someone, and they stepped out for a second. So he's like... And then it was gone. I was like, the only time in my life I froze. It was the only time. Say what everyone else says. I've got to think of something different. And then he's gone.
Because I don't think much of your rubber shark.
Well, it's a good job the script around it was amazing. But
have you ever used any Spielberg stuff in your movies?
Yeah, I rip him off all the time.
What do you say is what you normally do or take from Restart?
I think I take a lot of the way he stages things. In fact, I used a shot.
Vehicle enough. You used a vehicle after vehicle,
Yeah, for sure. But he's got this really, I mean, a shot that I talk about a lot, which I try to emulate, is he was the master of the one shot scene without you knowing it. Like there are directors out there who do great one take. Zemeckis is brilliant, but it's real showboating. It's real like you really go, wow, this, we haven't cut yet. What's going on? It's amazing. But with Spielberg, there's so many shots where when I got a bit older, one of my favorite shots is in Raiders of the Lost Ark, and it's when Denham Elliott goes to Indy's house to tell him that they've given him the go ahead to go after the Ark. And it's inside, and you've got the front door. Delamere comes in, and they have a little chat, and then we track back, and they go in the room, and then we just slowly creep through the door. The door frame sort of widens out, and then we go. Becomes this great two shot with Harrison Ford in the foreground, and then he goes over there. Then he's standing. Yeah, he gets the case out like that, and then he's over there, and it's beautiful. And he comes over there, and then he starts talking about the Ark, and Denham Elliott starts talking about the spirituality of it, and we start tracking in on him. Harrison Ford goes out of the shot. We go in, and then Harrison Ford comes into the shot, going, "Oh, Marcus, you don't believe all that, right?" And he goes out and he gets out, and he gets the gun, and then there's just one quick cut of the gun, and then bam, and then you're off to. And I show that to students all the time. I say, "Watch this. This is a masterpiece of staging, and to achieve that, you've got two. Nine of you got amazing. It's an exposition scene. Now, as a director, to doing an exposition scene and not cutting it, not so you haven't got the option to cut it up and go, oh my God, this is exposition. This is a pure exposition scene. And that guy, at that age, where they're literally just talking about plot. They're just setting up the plot, okay. You know. And an exposition is where you're just getting information now. And as a writer, exposition is the bane because you've got to try and you've got to get such important information into the audience, but you've got to disguise it as natural dialogue, and you've got to make it feel natural and all that. It is really hard. Any writer will tell you exposition is the worst, and this is one of the major exposition scenes of the movie, and he does it all in this one shot with no safety net. There's no way to cut out of it, no way to cut it up to change it around, and the guy, the confidence of doing that, absolutely. And I just, that stuff I'm in awe of. And I try and do that stuff when I can. I love, not just because I think it's cool, and because I think it's, but mainly because, particularly I use that as an example, because I'd never noticed for a long time that it was one shot. Yeah, because basically just by not cutting, you are as an audience member, you're just doing this. You're going in. And that's when I realized the power of that kind of filmmaking. Of that really beautifully considered, designed filmmaking, and that's why. And then, you know, there's all kinds of other styles that are great, and I love all styles of filmmaking. But for me, that gets me leaning in. He got a lot of that. He definitely got a lot of that from David Lean. Mm-hmm. David Lean was very good at that. Yeah, you look at some of David Lean's master shots. They all
mentioned the searches, don't they?
Yeah. All those are classic John Ford, but Orson Welles as well. Orson Welles was a master of that. You know, the opening shot of Touch of Evil is just mind blowing. I mean, you think about, and also Powell and Pressburger as well. Powell and Pressburger, the Red Shoes, Life and Death of Colonel Blimp, Matter of Life and Death. With David Niven these are British guys, and this was 1940s.
Yeah, a lot of it comes from
British. Yeah, these were and Spielberg and Lucas and Coppola, Scorsese, they will all say Powell and Pressburger are one of their biggest influences. Yeah, these two British guys. Yeah. Sorry. See, this is my problem.
We've got it. We must be out by 10. Ah. But I think we can all say a huge thank you to Brad for giving up his evening and for talking. 10 to the dozen, and so many stories, and so many films, and so many images, so many ideas, and it's been fascinating. And I've got 110 questions, and I've only given 5. But I guess we all owe you a great round of applause.
No problem. That's great. And look, when I'm. Thank you very much. I love geeking out with people. It's my favourite thing. But you know, I'm local, so I'll happily come along again, and not be centre of attention, but come and hang out and chat more, or whatever. And do all that. You know, I just like talking about this stuff with people.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.